We're in a series that Todd has been preaching over the last few weeks, a great series entitled The Nine. It is taken from and drawn from Galatians 5, where Paul gives us a picture of these nine fruits of the Spirit, these nine evidences that the Spirit lives in us, that we've accepted Christ and that His great Holy Spirit is drawing out of us and pouring out of us these great fruits. It's taken again from Galatians 5:22 and goes like this. The Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, just as love, joy, and peace, and patience has produced all kinds of challenges and opportunities, so it will also be true with this fruit we're going to study today, and that is goodness. Now, I was at a restaurant last night with my wife, and we happened to see this sign that was written above the place where we get our food. Take a look at this. So, as we were eating, I saw this, and it just jumped off the page. I've been working all week on this sermon, and when I read this, I thought, choose the harder right instead of the easier wrong. How many days, how many moments within each day are we faced with the decision to choose the harder right instead of the easier wrong? And so I thought, what a great thing. And so I snapped a picture of that. And that's just going to kind of be the attitude and the theme as we go through today's sermon. As we study this idea of goodness, it's hard to know where to start. Because if there's been any word in our culture that has been just pillaged of its original meaning, it's good. Like, what does it mean to be good these days? For some people, it is the idea of, well, it's a whole list of things that I don't do. If you want to know why I'm good, look at what I don't do. I don't drink. I don't do drugs. I don't beat my children. I pay my taxes on time. Look at all the things that I have pushed out of my life. No rated R movies. And so, therefore, I must be good. Now, on the other side of the ledger, there's another group of people that say, no, it's not just about what you don't do, it's about what you do. And so they would say, but look, I volunteer, I pay tithes, and look, I give to charity, I pay my taxes on time. Look at all the things that I do to show that I'm good. And so ultimately, I think the real question we need to ask ourselves is, what is God's definition of good? It is one thing to define in our own hearts where the bar is with good, but what is God's definition? Now, many of us in our lives have physical manifestations, people in our life that we would say, that person is good. And I've had people like that in my life. One of them in particular was my grandfather, Merlin Burkholder. Merlin Burkholder was just the best. He was a true man of God. He walked back and forth to the little church across from the farm his whole life. And he was just a good man. I've seen it all my life. He owned a small business here in the community, and everybody recognized him as just this honorable man of integrity. I can remember I used to practice hitting golf balls out at the farm where he lived. It was just kind of big, wide open spaces. And I have a tendency to slice the ball, probably more of a habit of slicing the ball. And I sliced a golf ball one day right through a window at the farm. So, hey, Grandpa, I'm so sorry. I broke this window. And, oh, that's all right. I'll go pick up some glass. So he went and got the glass. And when he came back, he brought me the little paper ticket from the hardware store, $4.78. And so Grandpa brought this over. And, okay, well, hey, you bet. And I pull out a $5 bill and hand it to him. And thanks, Grandpa. He says, now, wait a minute. This is only $4.78. I'm like, well, keep the change. I mean, it's not a problem. At 22, and he's like, no, sir, you wait right there. I'll never forget it. I was a young man. He said, you wait right there. And he went into the house. He had this old oak desk in his little study. And out of the drawer, he pulls his little change purse where he kept his checkbook and everything. And he shelled out 22 cents. Now everything's square. Everything's good. And we're good to go. And he handed me the receipt. And that's just how he was. Now, just a couple of years ago, I had the distinct just honor and pleasure to be a part of his celebration of life service. Since that last story, my grandmother and my grandfather has passed away, and during that service, it was such a beautiful thing. People began to share all of these stories and examples of who my grandfather had been and how he just typified good. He just typified goodness. And one local business owner shared this story. It was Grandpa and my grandmother's habit to be very routine. They had their schedule. They had their days of the week where they went to this store and to that place. And it was their habit on such and such a day of the week to go to this little store in Stewart's Draft where they would buy their snack cakes. And they had two kinds that they always bought, and they always went to this aisle on this day, and the store just kind of took them in. They would just kind of adopted them as this sweet couple, and it was like a little date night for them. Like, they would just go to the store, and every week they would come and do this routine. And Grandpa would go, they would pick up these two, they would bring them to the register, he would pay for it, he would get a couple of pencils out of this little jar in front of the cash register, tuck them into the bag, and out they would walk. And as they shared in this little letter at his funeral, week after week, month after month, they carried this little routine out. It was just such a special thing. They looked forward to seeing him every day of the week that they came. And every time, buy the things, get a couple of pencils. They said it was just like clockwork. Now, the person that owned the store said, we would never share then what we're going to share now. That for all of those years, all of that repetition, every sweet time that they came in and went through that routine, and they would pay for those things and they would get a couple pencils out of the little jar and tuck them in their bag. We failed to tell him then, but we'll tell you now, that those pencils were for sale. My grandfather, if he had any idea that for 3.5 years, one of the most good people in all of Augusta County had been shoplifting for the final years of his life, he would literally reach through eternity with $4.60 and say, no, I want to make that right. Hilarious. Listen, but what is good? What is it that God tells us good is? Now, I want to share a startling verse with you that as I read this, it's just like, now, wait a minute. How do we deal with this? It's actually spoken by Jesus himself in Matthew 5:48. And he says this about how good God expects us to be. You are to be perfect, even as your Father and in heaven as perfect. You are to be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. I don't know about you. Maybe your response is similar to mine. Houston, yeah, we have a problem, and it's a significant problem, because not only am I not perfect and nowhere close, I'm not even trending that way. Like, I'm not even headed towards perfect. I'm just kind of surviving. You know, I'm just trying to stay above water and hope that God is gonna continue to offer that forgiveness and that grace to me. But that is Jesus' expectation. That is God's expectation. And so into that great problem, into that impossible cliff that we face of perfection, Jesus walks. And he walks into our life, and he's wielding a powerful remedy for our lack of perfection and goodness. And it is called grace. Grace, God's riches at Christ's expense. And he offers us this beautiful free gift of grace where he will overlook, he will cover all of the iniquity, all of the sin in our life. Now, while that gift is free to us, we only need to accept it. It was not free. In fact, it carried a great price. In 1 Corinthians 6:20, it says simply this, for God bought you with a high price. You see, that price would cost God his only son. And it would cost his only son, Jesus, his very life. So God's expectation is perfection. We are incapable of perfection. So God provided a sacrifice for our sin through Jesus. And this is what we call grace. Now, there's a question that immediately follows in my mind. So if all of my sin has been covered by Jesus' grace, all of my sin past and in the future has been covered by his grace, then do I now have the liberty to do what I want? Can I now live as I please because God's grace, his free gift, unearned, now covers all of my sin? The great apostle Paul, in writing this letter to the Roman church, says this in Romans 6:1. Well then, should we keep on sinning so that God can show us more and more of his wonderful grace? Of course not. Since we have died to sin, how can we continue to live in it? He continues in verse 12. Do not let sin control the way you live. Do not give in to sinful desires. Do not let any part of your body become an instrument of evil to serve sin. Instead, give yourselves completely to God, for you were dead, but now you have new life. You see, God's expectation of each person in this room that has decided to follow him and live for Christ is not to merely be saved, but to be good. Now, goodness is the fruit and the evidence, the result of the Holy Spirit living in you. But we are not robots. You are not a puppet on the string, some automatron that once the Holy Spirit enters into your body, you are simply controlled and must do everything that he says. You have the terrible and powerful gift of free will. And so every day we have the opportunity to choose to obey our sinful nature, that quiet call of our flesh, or listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Paul, again, in his letter to the Galatians, this is an amazing scripture and so true if we're in touch with what's happening in our hearts. Galatians 5:17, the Spirit gives us desires that are opposite of what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other. Have you experienced the battle? Can you experience what it's like then what God wants for you, what he's pouring into your heart is being battled every day by the flesh that you carry and walk in every day? People that are led by the Spirit will practice and discipline themselves to overcome the enticing whispers and the lure of their fleshly desires, and instead will practice pure life-giving habits. Paul hammers this home in Philippians 4:8. It's a beautiful scripture. Fix your thoughts on what is true. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Listen to this very closely. Keep putting into practice all that you learn. And listen, I don't know what you practice. I don't know what you have practiced and became good at. Sometime in the eighth grade, our shop teacher in Stewart's Draft Middle School decided that we were going to make this cool little project. We took a piece of wood and cut it into a little triangle, and with a drill press, we drilled these little holes in it, and we made one of those little peg jumpy games that you play at, like Cracker Barrel. I don't know what they're called, but they're addictive and they're super fun, and so we got to make our own. And so all week we worked on it, we stained it, and we sanded every little peg, and I was so proud of that thing. And I decided that summer, when I took it home, I set it on my little table, and I just decided that summer, I'm going to own this game. Like, I'm so tired of being made look like a fool by this little game. Have you ever read the back of it? It's so rude. Right? I mean, you're just at Cracker Barrel wanting some bacon and eggs, and all of a sudden you're an idiot. It's like, I just wanted to jump the pegs. You know, I didn't know I was going to be a fool. And so I determined my eighth grade year, I'm going to figure this thing out. And so I took one day of my life. You only get so many, right? And I'm like, well, I'm giving one day of my life. I'm going to crush this game. And so I did. I remember being on my knees on my carpeted floor, my little game peg game on the bed, and I just worked it. And I worked it. And I worked it, and I practiced until I would get down to four, and then I got down to three, and then I finally got down to two, and then eventually I figured out how to get it down to one. And then I repeated it over and over again, and then I had a party in my room. Like, it was like, yeah! And so I practiced that thing until I finally, now it's been an amazing blessing ever since. Practicing that thing has made going to Cracker Barrel so much fun. Right? I mean, my family knows I know how to do it, but when I'm out with you, I've never done it before in my life. Yeah. And so I always let you go first. I'm like, man, this game is crazy hard. Here, you try it. And you do it, and you're like, okay, I had four. I said, well, that means you're an idiot. Okay, pass it to me. let me see what I can do. This thing's so crazy. And then, you got to pretend like you've never done it before. You're like, so I just jump one at a time? Okay. And you scratch your head, and you pound your fist, like, come on, I'm so close. And then eventually, and everybody thinks you're like, it says you're a genius. I know. That's amazing. Listen, what is it that you have practiced in your life to become good at? What is it that you're practicing? The Apostle John, one of Jesus' closest followers, would illustrate it this way. In 1 John 3:7, dear children, don't let anyone deceive you about this. When people do what is right, it shows that they are righteous, even as Christ is righteous. But when people keep on sinning, it shows that they belong to the devil, who has been sinning since the beginning. But the Son of God came to destroy the works of the devil. Those who have been born unto God's family do not make a practice of sinning. Just as practicing goodness is a sign of the Spirit living in our lives, the fruit of the Spirit, when we practice sinning, we are revealing that we are not God's, but in control of Satan himself. Now listen, you may be wondering, what kind of a church did I show up to? If you're visiting here for the first time, the preacher just said that people that are living in sin are under the control of the evil one. That's what the Bible says. Now there is an eternal difference in sinners. There's an eternal difference because I think we'd all agree, or I hope you agree. Let me just say it, we're all sinners. The preacher standing up here today is a sinner. And I struggle with sin, and I believe I will until I die, but there's an eternal difference between sinners. You see, there's a difference between the man that practices sin and stumbles into goodness, and the man that practices goodness yet stumbles into sin. There is an incredible, powerful difference of motive and intent on both parties. The Apostle Paul, the writer of much of your New Testament, this great man of God that would go on to die for Christ, an incredible witness of Jesus, would give these transparent words about his own heart. If you've never read Romans 7, it is one of the most honest and relatable books in all the Scripture. Let me give you a piece of it right now. This is Paul speaking of himself. I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart, but there is another power within me that is at war against my mind. This power makes me a slave to sin that is still within me. I want you to notice something very important here. Even as Paul admits his failure and inability to be everything God wants him to be, I want you to notice his intent. The intent and desire of his heart is to be good, to be holy. Now contrast that attitude of Paul with another group of people that he describes in his letter to the Romans, in Romans 1:18. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who, listen, suppress the truth by their wickedness. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God or gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. In verse 24, he continues, therefore, God gave them over in sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies for one another. They, listen closely, they exchanged the truth about God for a lie. And listen, this is just like one of us goes to the store and we buy a shirt and we bring it home and we try it on. And we say, you know what? This shirt doesn't feel right. This shirt doesn't look good. This shirt doesn't fit right. So I'm going to take it back and I'm going to take it to the store and I'm going to go to the clerk and say, man, this shirt doesn't fit me. this shirt doesn't feel right on me, so I'm going to exchange it, and I'm going to exchange it for something completely different. Now, it's one thing when we're talking about a shirt, isn't it? But what happens when we're talking about God? Exchanging the truth of God for a lie. God, what you have done for me, what you have given me, no longer feels good. It no longer fits with my lifestyles and the thing I want to do with my time. So God, I'm going to exchange this. And I want to buy a lie in its place. The difference is clear. One man strives for goodness and despite failure, fights to grow more and more like Jesus every day. The other, there is no striving at all. Instead, they are resigned to living in sin, hoping, I suppose, that while they have rejected God's command to be good, that they might still receive his grace. Listen, in the church, the line between those practicing godly goodness and worldly sin has gotten more and more difficult to determine. Not because God's expectations have been lowered. God's expectations have always been where they have been, but it's gotten confusing because people of the church, we are trying to do the impossible. We are trying to practice both sin and goodness at the same time. We are trying to practice, put into practice purity and impurity at the same time. The Apostle Paul, just a couple of verses, as he's writing the fruits of the Spirit, two verses before, he gives this warning. Now, the actions of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, promiscuity, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, rivalry, jealousy, outbursts of anger, quarrels, conflicts, factions, envy, and murder. Drunkenness, wild partying, and things like that, I am telling you now, he would say, as I have told you in the past, that people who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Tragically, this culture of sin is incredibly evident in the church today. This may be one of the greatest moral failures and blind spots of our time. Listen to these statistics. Recently, the Barna Group examined current pornography use and found that 55% of Christian men are viewing pornography. 30% of men under 30 are looking at it on a daily basis. 1 in 6 women are becoming addicted to pornography. The teenage statistics, our little boys, our young men, over 90% have looked at pornography before they're at the age of 18. Over 30% look at it routinely in the church. What is happening to the body of believers, the reflection of Christ himself? Listen, in the last decade, drunkenness has become more prevalent in the church. Not having a beer with dinner, not having a glass of wine at a wedding, but literally Christians getting together, breaking and open a six-pack, and everybody's getting buzzed at drunk in the church. Men and women living together before marriage and having sex before marriage is prevalent, even common, in the church today. A Barna survey revealed that 65% of men and women in the U.S. agree that trying out your partner is crucial to a healthy marriage. Trying out your partner? As if they were some kind of a shirt that you're trying on to see if it fits. And while you sleep together and live together, that if it doesn't fit, what's next? To just exchange it out for another? Do we really feel like this is God's intention for sexuality and for our marriages? The list does not stop at sexual sin and drunkenness, however. Have I asked myself honestly, is my life marked by practicing jealousy, hatred, fits of rage, and quarreling? Has the church stopped being a hospital of healing for the hurting and instead become a haven and hangout for the self-indulgent? Where did we buy the lie that as long as we get saved, we don't have to be good? we have received this compassionate reminder from God in Romans 6:20. When you were slaves to sin, you were free from the obligation to do what is right. And what was the result? You are now ashamed of the things you used to do, things that end in eternal doom, but now you are free from the power of sin and have become slaves of God. Now you do those things that lead to holiness and result in eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Listen, can we be open and honest? Can we just put this in a nutshell, put it in our own vernacular, our own language? If we are living in open and intentional sin, literally practicing the regular use of pornography, living in the practice of hatred, jealousy, practicing a lifestyle of premarital sex, practicing homosexual sex, if you are cheating on your spouse, you are living completely outside of the will of God for your life. And until you turn away from that sin, you see, there's that great word, repentance. You'll see it all through Scripture. It's always connected to the idea of following Jesus Christ. And it is this idea. It simply means to turn. To turn from that way that you are going and turn towards Christ and to the direction that He's leading you. Listen. At worst, we have trampled on the very grace of Jesus Christ that was bought with His blood. We have literally trampled on the grace that was bought at such a high price. But even more dangerous than that, it is possible that we have forfeited and exchanged our eternity for a momentary pleasure and a lie. Listen, this morning, we will once again partake of a meal that we take here every Sunday. It is the representation of that great price paid for the grace that allows us to walk freely from sin. Every sin in our past, every sin in our future has been paid for by Christ. How is it then that we trample on that great offer of grace on this meal by keeping this one secret closet in our hearts, one door that we will not open, because we feel like that thing is okay. As long as I'm practicing going to church, then I can practice this on the side. When God says, when I died for you, I died to take it all. I want you to be free, unchained, unhindered from the tentacles that sin has on your life. So this morning, as these emblems are passed, the bread which represents God's body broken, the blood representing Jesus' blood shed, that you would look deep into your heart. And wherever those shadowy corners are, those little secret sins that have left over and continue to rob you of the life God wants, I pray that today you will seek forgiveness from that and find a new start and a new joy and a new fulfillment in life that I can promise you, until that sin is taken away, you'll never experience. Let's pray. Father, we just want to thank you for being long-suffering. Over and over in the Bible, you are described as a long-suffering God who is patient with us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to eternal life. God, will you help us to be good? And we can only be good by your Spirit. Father, as we remember you this morning, will you just pour your love into us so we can experience a freedom never felt before? Amen.